All right, good morning, everybody. Thanks so much for being here. This is 2020 Evolving Asian American Theater. So, brief intros. My name is Jeff Liu. I'm a director based in LA. To my left is Victor, you pronounce it Mayog. Mm-hmm. Okay, Victor Mayog, who is a freelance director, AD of Second Generation Productions in New York. Next to him is Leslie Ishii, an actress, a director, a teaching artist, also co-facilitator for TCG Diversity Inclusion Institute. And next to her is Roger Tang, producer, playwright, ED of Pork-Filled Players in Seattle, also editor of the invaluable, indispensable Asian American Theater Review. All of you are members of that, right? And get the digest? Yeah? Everyone, okay. Okay, so here we go. Today we are looking at models of ethnic-specific theater, which I think we can all agree is one form of home that we have created for ourselves. From one and only one in 1965, Useless Players, to now, we're talking how many, Roger?
Several dozen.
Of course, it's always a bit of a struggle staying alive. Some go, some are formed, but we're going to talk a bit about that, some of the best practices, the ways in which theaters have had to change to accommodate audience, community, what have you. And then after that, I want to get onto how these theaters are also called upon to interact with the mainstream, sometimes do battle with the mainstream, whatever that is. It's an interesting question yesterday, I think it was Andrea who brought up, well, is integration the goal? I don't know that it has to be the only goal, but I think it's clear from the last panel that these are battles that have to be fought. They're going to be fought whether we fight them well or not, so we might as well fight them well, it strikes me. But we'll get to that in a moment. So first, we'll talk about certain models of ethnic-specific theater, and I'll also pause at different times so that you guys can chime in and keep us all on time. We'll see if we can do this. So Victor, you want to start off?
Sure. Thanks, Jeff. Good morning, everybody. I'm Victor Mayog. I'm the artistic director of 2G Second Generation in New York. And raise your hand if this is your first kata conference.
Oh, good.
Cool.
Yeah. Yes. I asked because it's my first one as well. Yes, so hello. Welcome. I think one of the things that I want to be able to articulate today as we sort of move forward, and I think it works with plays as well and any all sorts of initiatives, that we actually have to go back to, at least even on a personal basis, our origin stories, right? So there's a sense of contextualization between where we're going and really the resonance of how it started. And I think that's been an interesting part of this journey for me. And I'm going to be focusing mainly on some of the New York transformations, because that's where I've been in since 1995, though Teatro Nantanan in San Francisco gave me my first professional directing job. And actually just this year, Rick Chiomi and Randy Reyes commissioned me to write my first full-length play. So Asian American theater has been very, very generous to me and giving me a start. So we know Pan-Asian Rep came out of that Tisa's collaboration with Ellen Stewart, and she said, and please chime in here anytime, Tisa, she wanted to create a space for Asian American artists, but also to make Asian American works popular. And she's been doing that, and she's really been a beacon for that sort of work. And further along, I think around 1989 or so, came Mayi Theater, trying to find a home for Filipino artists that eventually started to change in the late 90s to try to be much more expansive, to try to be to have a sort of a pan-Asian focus. And then in 04, there was a writer's lab that happened with Mayi that focused in creating a home for Asian American writers, which now I think is about 30 writers, and those works go throughout the country. With NATCO, that started in 1989 with Mia and Richard Eng, trying to create works that that wanted to really put value on Asian American contributions in this culture. And so with that, their mission is to create works, how are Asian Americans positioned in European works? And then I've seen that move through adaptations of work, and then I know Amiya is now starting to commission work as well. Lately, I've noticed the work of Bayork Lee in the National Asian Artist Project, and Bayork said to me, who was in the original chorus line, she goes, it's taken me so long to come back here, but I'm coming back, and now I want to train our Asian American artists to really work in musical theater through a national chorus, through classic musicals like Oliver, and so that's happened over the last couple of years. And also there is the Leviathan Lab that I know Ariel has started, that is a studio that has film, that has actually done site-specific work, and I know now they're in the middle of another transition. They've also done some Shakespeare as well. And when I came on to 2G 2 years ago, it was working in sort of short form plays. When it started in 1997 with Welly Yang, he wanted to do large scale musicals because he had gotten some parts in Miss Saigon, and then he said, well, where else do I go after this? So he wanted to create a vehicle for that called Making Tracks that actually explored Japanese internment, the Chinese railroads. And after Lloyd Sutt took over, he really worked inward and tried to create a space for Asian American writers to just work, just to do it, to write their first play. And Carla took that to an even further level, where she said, well, let's do some puppetry. Let's begin to expand sort of the forms that we're working with and sort of tap into the restlessness of what we're supposed to do. And so when I took over about 2 years ago, I said, well, now that we've cultivated this community, how do we actually then begin to not just move inward, but move outward? Now that we have the skills, people have been trained, people are getting experiences, how do we begin to move forward in the work? And so that's part of what our work is now, is to return to full production and try to bring this community both to the mainstream, but at the same time, if we're saying we're being neglected by some folks in the mainstream, the question that we're talking about at 2G is who in our own community are we ignoring? And so we started a program a few years ago called Community Voices, and it was a program for LGBTQ API. So a place for them to write the first plays, a place for them to actually have a place to talk, and we're hoping to continue that program as well. So, yes?
Victor, let me just jump in now for just a second, yeah, because I have to leave and go float around to see the other panels at the meeting. But going back to Pan-Asian Lab, which was founded in 77, as the oldest Asian professional Asian American theater company on the East Coast, that era, I just want to say how important it is, because it was also an act of taking just our destiny in our own hands.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Yeah, exactly.
Activism was providing opening opportunities for Asian American actors who have been marginalized from the mainstream. So I think some of these issues are still so current and reverberate, yeah, to this day. And mm-hmm. there are other breakouts and panels wanting to explore this more. So I think it's very important to say we started it then, we are still continuing this this whole thing about equity on Broadway.
Yeah,
exactly. Years. I don't even see Asian American dancers in chorus very often. I mean, a few, of course, have gotten, you know, Andrew Sanjata is up there. There are James Kandashi that's been on Broadway. Sorry. And so,
thanks. Dominate this, but I think that so many of the reasons that Pan-Asian was founded, and what you talked a little bit about the artistic repertoire, of course, is highly expansive, and I'm just so happy that I see so many now younger people and artists following in the same tracks, I think our trajectory has really spawned so many tentacles, and you're carrying it on in your own individual ways, in singular, creative, distinctive ways. So I feel very gratified. I said yesterday, I'm the grandma, the old Buddha. You know, the Empress of China was called the old Buddha. Well, so I just wanted to say that act of activism and for political change is still going on. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. And just a little footnote, when I got appointed to the Kata board and became artistic director of 2G, it was Tisa who wrote me right away and said, will you come and meet with me? So thank you. Okay. So that's where we are.
Yeah. Cool. Roger, Leslie, do either of you want to add something about some of the cases you've seen in terms of ethnic-specific theaters?
I was here, I first got started in Asian American theater, was only five, and for years we used to put in our thing, into our case statements at Northwest Asian American Theater, one of only five across the country, and right in the middle of the 90s, it just exploded. And there were so many, and it's hard for me to keep up, even though it's a self-appointed job for me to try to keep up with all the people who are doing stuff. I know I'm only catching around, 50, 60% of what's going on around the country. So it's like, it's just been, great, diversification of voices, because, our voice is so full, so multidimensional that one organization can't possibly hold it. So.
I would just add, East West Players is beginning to celebrate its 50th, anniversary, and we're the oldest POC theater in the country now. So we hold the mantle with this sort of pride, but also a little bit of sadness that others have fallen away, knowing sometimes it's time for theaters to fall away and other things grow and come up new. I come from the Northwest Asian American Theater. I too feel the Asian Theater has been incredibly generous in giving me opportunity to develop and continue my livelihood. There's Mo'olelo in San Diego. Of course, there's a plethora of theaters in the Bay Area, the West Coast, and we've already mentioned MOOC Performing Arts. So it's gratifying to see that we're national. It's not in just these major pockets now on the coasts. We're national all throughout.
Yeah, Texas even. It's like, it struck me, that we had their South Asian theaters in Texas, and there are people up in Florida, and I've seen people in Georgia, do stuff. So that's kind of a little astonishing, for me. But it's like it's very heartening because, everybody's finding their voices.
I would also add that I'll mention a few sort of turning points that may or may not be interesting to you, but also realize that all of these theaters and the people in them are a resource to you. If something comes up, maybe in the future, don't hesitate to contact them, because 9 out of 10, they'll try and tell you what they went through. But for East West, a few moments is one thing that has successfully been done over the 50 years is two transitions of artistic directorship power, which is not the easiest thing to do. And believe me, there was drama. So I'm not going to go into all of that. But I think it's very interesting how you survive that and go on and what is sometimes necessary in that. Number two is... Yeah, the move of space from a 99-seat theater equity waiver plan to a full-on equity contract mid-sized theater. That involved a capital campaign, that all kinds of things that are kind of fraught, because everyone knows mid-sized theater is one of the most difficult to stay alive. So, corner Tim Dang if you want to know about that. Okay. The other thing is, and this partly came out of one of these Kata conferences, is the recognition that, wow, we have to do more to fully include the South Asian community under the umbrella of Asian American theater. And this is something Tim committed to. And basically, among other things, he said, okay, then we're going to do one South Asian main stage play out of the four every year. And this is now in the fourth season of that, which is ongoing to that. So I just wanted to mention those. A couple of other things. We've talked about MU. I think MU is a great example of taking what is sort of unique to the Minnesota Asian American community and reflecting that, especially, you know, the focus on Korean adoptee and also Hmong work, which is very unique, which I found very moving also through this conference when some of those people came and talked about what it was like to develop work there. I also wanted to mention Silk Road.
Yes.
By defining Asian America this way, right, which allows them to also embrace many predominantly Muslim countries and all along, I think it makes them extremely relevant now. This is partly what I think Andrea was talking about, because I know that's still uncomfortable, even talking to folks of, well, is Arabic culture? Yeah, exactly. And I think people are divided about it. I did also want to link to that, give a shout out to Ayad Akhtar, who I believe is now officially the second Asian-American playwright to make Broadway after David Henry Hwang. Is that correct? Am I spreading a vicious rumor? Who's second?
Rajiv Joseph.
Oh, right. Rajiv Joseph, sorry. Okay. And Ayad, I think, is maybe one of the most important playwrights right now because he's writing about Islam in a way that the mainstream Lord audiences can understand and want to buy tickets to. That's a very sort of unique combination of qualities, which I think is very interesting. Does anyone want to chime in and yell really loudly something they want to talk about now? A case study that you feel like everyone needs to hear, like right now, or you can always save it till the end. Yeah. Cool. Can anyone throw out a few of the have Asian American companies been doing this kind of work? Yeah.
Cis Productions, they do an annual theatrical walking tour of the International District for multiple reasons. We wanted to actually lift up, it's a neighborhood that's been in existence and has a long historical place, obviously, for Asian Pacific Islanders, but it's not one of the more trafficked neighborhoods, so there's a lot of perceptual problems where people think of it in certain ways as being dangerous or, you know, not a place to take their families. And so we started doing these site-specific tours where we actually, first year was focusing on people who live and work there, the second year was on people why they go there, third year was on Bruce Lee for any reasons, and then recently, we just finished last weekend, was about women who have made a difference in ID, but if you Google, if you try to do any research, there's no documented record of these women and their lives and the contributions they made to the neighborhood, other than in their own stories. And so what we did was we actually cite and commission local Asian American writers to write pieces based on what their experiences have been.
Thank you. Okay, great. And then they actually, we site them in different places throughout the International District, and then we actually take people on a real walking tour, which is a huge thing in Seattle. And then they encounter them in the open spaces, in the parks, in the alleyways. And so there's a real blend between what reality is and people actually getting to experience it. We also do it in historical spaces, so like the Wing Luke Asian Museum, where it was converted from an old historical building that has a long history, in 100-some-year history. And then we actually cite by actually placing actors in the different historical areas of the museum so that they actually, people can actually see what life was like had they been to this hotel that's been converted to a museum. So we've been doing more of that stuff. We want to move into doing some more environment, I mean, like really specific out and exterior spaces, but that's what we've been doing.
I think, Jeff, if you're asking for a shout-out for companies doing things, so I guess a company that's been a big friend to Asian American companies is Yellow Earth Theatre, based in London, which for many years did readings of Asian American plays over, I don't know how many years, maybe five, six, 7 years. So, you know, and one of the last plays that he produced and toured nationally was Wave by Sung Ren Oh. So that did a UK national tour that I produced and directed. Unfortunately, that company's probably winding down, so by the end of this year, it won't be exist anymore. We'll see. I hope not. But I think that, you know, and they're new friends for internationally for Asian American theatre companies that are, you know, very receptive. So I think that as we go look further on in this discussion, once we've covered the domestic, perhaps we can have a look at the international.
I saw, I think, two comments back there, and then we're going to move on, okay? And we'll come back. Yeah, can you?
Thanks. Hi, I'm Katie. I live in Austin. It will toot my own horn, but it is to answer May's question. I do not run an Asian American company, but we are mostly people of color who are mostly queer identified, who are mostly women or female assigned gender at birth. We do a site-specific project regularly. I think almost every year we did a piece called Before This Was Texas, which is about relating to the land of Texas. And so as an Asian American, I would look at language around invasive species, but also my collaborators were Chicano or of indigenous descent, and so it was an interesting way that we related specifically to the land in our bodies. And so my company is called the Generic Ensemble Company, and we're based in Austin. We are not Asian American, but I'm Asian American, and we're trying to work across race and ethnicity. So I think I saw, was it you? Oh, okay.
Hi, I'm Leilani Chan. I'm with Theater Productions. We're based in Los Angeles, and we're actually culminating a two-year cycle of what we're calling pop-up theater. We got funding from Irvine Foundation to do this work with restaurant workers, and we wanted restaurant workers to be able to participate in the work. So we kind of going with this pop-up restaurant, pop-up flash mob style theaters so that restaurant workers could perform in the work. And we've been doing so that there's minimal rehearsals, but it's site-specific performances around Los Angeles. And then I also wanted to mention Pangea World, this is answering May's question, of course. Pangea World Theater got the coveted Art Place grant to do a really, that's a major, major competitive national grant, to do site-specific work. Mina would probably talk more specifically about it, but to do work around an area that's being gentrified, but working with immigrant communities to do site-specific work in that area to engage with how that community is changing. But I guess what I'm thinking is, how do we tie this to what you're talking about? It's very different doing this placemaking work and working with community-based work. And then talking about representation in the theater. So I guess I'll just voice a question I'm having, is what is the hope then? You know, because I've gone another route where I want to work with my community and I want to talk about stories. I also am cynical in that I don't think the mainstream is going to change until we can prove to them we have an audience. And only through community work is my belief that it can happen. So I'm just opening that up for dialogue. Give me some hope. That mainstream can change. I'd love to hear it.
Cool. We will be getting there. All right. Okay. So that's a nice segue. Every now and then, while our theaters and homes are, you know, struggling, trying to survive, get an audience, all that, something will happen that requires some kind of response. It's 25 years after Miss Saigon, and these things happen, and you go, wow, have we had any impact at all? Really? But, of course, every one of these flashpoints is also an opportunity of some kind, right? So I think Roger's going to talk a bit about that.
Well, I'm going to talk a little bit about this, because basically it's like there are these things that have been happening across the country, and it's like I started adding these up and said, oh my God, this is a huge list. It's like, okay, I have a big file full of instances that, across the country. Like and across the world. I mean, you know, we all know about the Nightingale in San Diego, where they cast you know, all the major roles of white people, and they excuse that this was a fantasy China, but San Diego's an area with major Asian American population. In Chicago, there is Pippin, a Bollywood spectacular. They did a Bollywood version of Pippin. Only one API in the show. The rest was white, and there's no South Asians on the production staff. We can hop on over to England. Orphan of Zao, we know all about that. The original thing with the Royal Shakespeare Company cast all the major roles as white actors because Asian actors would not be credible in other roles they were doing in their repertoire. Popping back over to Broadway, there's Priscilla, Queen of the Desert. They were, when they're casting roles, they say they're seeking for quote unquote Cynthia, female, 20s to 30s, Asian. Actor can be any ethnicity as long as she can convincingly portray Asian on stage. As if there were no Asians around in New York with all these New York Asian American theater companies they could tap. There is the mystery of Edwin Drood at the Roundabout. White actors were cast to play two Sri Lankan characters, and they did so wearing brown face makeup as native Sri Lankans. It was so obvious, New York Times said, called out the production for silly imitation, exoticism, and absurd burnt umber makeup. I like that term. And let me see. And of course, locally, there's the here in Philadelphia. There is the Julius Caesar by Lantern Theater, where they had the concept of Japanese takeover of Rome, and then withdrew without ever leaving a Japanese person or mixed blood person behind. And they did not bother to consult anybody who's expert in Japanese culture. Call out Makoto Hirano for penning that absolutely wonderful piece of pinpointing every single thing that they did incorrectly in that piece. So, besides being that, I mean, the activism was a marvelous thing. I could a textbook case of how to do that. And of course, I guess which many of you heard, the Mikado has been a problematic case, not only in Seattle, but in Providence, Rhode Island, where they cast it entirely with all the roles with white actors. And at the same time, while trying to be accurate in their costuming and makeup and props as possible, paying more attention to the props and costume than they did to the ethnicity of the actors. Let me see. I think people have noticed that there, it was ignited by a Seattle Times article by a Seattle Times columnist that sparked a number of protests. People may not know about the Providence, Rhode Island case, in some ways it's quite worse. When somebody presented a petition to the producers, staff members said, we're sorry about, we understand what you're saying, what you're talking about, we're sorry about the offense. And then when it was bumped up the ladder to the president of the organization, they said, well, we fired that person. So that's a big, big, long list. And I know that, it's not, exhaustive. It's happening. And one of the main things I'm thinking, I say, what the hell? I mean, it's been 25 years since Miss Saigon, and it's still going on, and they're coming from people we think we should know better. So,
Yeah. That's a very interesting phrase in terms of we think we should know better, or these people should know better, right? And it raises something I've been thinking about, which is that conscious bias is something we all know about. Unconscious bias might actually be even more powerful. Looking at some of the science research about that kind of thing, is that there's a lot more stuff that doesn't have as much intentionality that we think. Like, we all think, yes, we're in control. We think we do the right thing. And often we don't. I think that's something worth thinking about as we deal with these different issues. Kathy, can I call on you since we've been talking? This is really interesting, I thought, because part of what we have to ask about these different events is what comes out of them, right? So it might be a panel, it might be a thing, like La Jolla Playhouse, right? Did you guys all watch that online? the sort of what comes out of that, and then how now those follow-up panels in LA, and then dealing able to get some of those major artistic directors into a room to at least pay lip service to talking about these things. Now, how many of them are serious about changing their organizations is a different matter, but through that, I think it becomes incumbent on us to identify who the real allies could and are going to be. It's not going to be everybody, but you don't need everybody, right? These relationships with OSF and with others partly came out of that because the issue became hot again, right? Because, and then if they have egg on their face, they're going to have motivation at least a while, right? A window, and how we capitalize on that. Kathy, can you talk a bit about what has come out of this most recent Mikado thing in Seattle?
Yeah, so the Seattle situation was a lot like what happened with the Nightingale in San Diego, where because of the yellow face casting in a particular show, it became this huge controversy, and a lot of people started protesting, but it was all based on emotion, which is completely valid, but it wasn't moving the dial forward. And the minute that editorial Times article hit, because I'd been following what had been happening around the country, I'm very fortunate, and I actually do have the privilege of working, I'm in charge of all the grant funding program for the arts in Seattle. So in that position, I immediately brought it to the mayor's attention and a lot of people in the city, and they were like, well, but we don't know if this is a big enough issue. So I kept pressing, and we actually were able to, I got the permission to host the forum with the Seattle rep, and from that forum, it was the first time we're actually in a room, and a lot of people said this, what made it amazing in Seattle, we're considered a very white, liberal, progressive community. And it was the first time it didn't feel like the people of color were in a room just talking to the choir, which is huge, because lots of times you have race conversations, and it's people of color talking with each other. Non-people of color never even deal with it, it's just, you know. But to actually have a room that was a mix, and so many people that were artists and arts administrators and arts leaders, artistic directors, board members in the room. And the goal, though, and I know I got a lot of flack from people of color, and specifically Asian Americans, and I'll, you know, and it was very uncomfortable, but because they didn't feel I pressed enough. They felt like the conversation was too polite, which Seattle really is, but what was great about it was, amazingly, so people of color, like, this was a great opportunity where you could have really said, this is the issues and why it's wrong. And but the non-people of color, from that same experience, they came up and they were like, oh my gosh, we had no idea. I mean, they really are living in a bubble and no idea that yellow face is an issue, that a lot of the structural racism that exists in our country still exists. And so it had to be a conversation of just introducing these ideas just enough where a lot of the non-people come in the room were like, I felt so uncomfortable. I felt like all this stuff was like becoming awareness for me that they never had before. But that was critical to get them there. If we had pushed their buttons too much, it would have been so easy for them to go, we can't even deal with this, and just walk away, right? And what's been really gratifying since then in the mayor's budget speech, never has the word arts even ever been mentioned, no matter which administration. In the most recent one, just happened a couple of weeks ago, the mayor of Seattle actually publicly said, he actually called out the Mikado incident in his budget speech, lauded our office, and said, this is an example of when a city employee sees an issue happening in the community that is important, it's about race and equity, and actually used this challenge as an opportunity to address it. But more importantly, a lot of the arts organization leaders have actually been coming and saying, you know, we need to figure out how we can work on this and change this. They'd never been aware that there was a problem, and that's the reality. Lots of us people of color, we automatically think, oh, everyone should know this is a problem. And then we're kind of blindsided when things happen, and we're like, don't they understand that it's a problem? And the reality is a lot of people don't. A lot of people, if it doesn't come across their consciousness on a day-to-day basis like it does for us people of color, it really isn't part of theirs. So we have to use those opportunities to see how we can move the dial forward. Sometimes moving the dial forward means being really strategic and building up for those moments when they come. Not, of course, coming from our passion, but not being so emotional that we're just looking at right now, I want to call it today, but help work together and partner with them to really address equity. And for the first time, our Arts Commission actually publicly stated at the Mayor's Arts Awards that now racial equity will be the main focus and priority of the work that they do, and they call the community to hold them accountable to that, that if they see instances of inequity happening, and with our funding, because we're working on actually getting approval of an equity fund that will actually give funding to organizations who are leading with equity, racial equity. And we are also, a lot of the arts organizations, like the HowlRound, which is one of the best and most established arts organizations in the city, they've been calling me weekly now saying, we want to hold more conversations like this. We need to like have this be a community in the forefront of our consciousness. And so it's been really inspiring to see the Ford movement because of taking a challenge and a controversy and turning it into opportunity to really make change.
I also want to point out the really interesting thing of how do you apply leverage to different parts, right? And funding is one of those things. This is a conversation we've been having in California as well, is that, well, okay, if you are accepting public funding and part of it is to support diversity and also to serve the community, what does it mean if you take that money and then your stuff isn't diverse and you import all your artists from New York anyway? So you're not even employing white LA theater artists, right? How do you call them out on it rather than letting them get away with it? And as soon as you get to money, right, people can get mad on the one hand, but they might also care more on the other hand, right? So then how do you balance those sort of the carrots and the sticks? The other thing is criteria. How do you become more specific about, well, how do you measure whether you've been genuine and successful in promoting diversity with the money, our taxpayer money that we've given you? Is it casting? Is it board? Is it staff? Is it all of the above? And there are ways to measure that. We had a comment. Urgent comments?
Just a quick footnote.
Let's give them the mic.
Just quick footnote, underscoring with Seattle Rep, if we're looking for allies in the field, Jeff Herman, who's the new executive director at Seattle Rep, this all blew out on the second day of the job. He had just literally walked in the door 2 days ago, and he was quick to action and really responsive. The show, as you probably know, was not a Seattle Rep production, but they were in Seattle Rep's house and they felt very responsible and responsive to the community. So I just want to acknowledge the allies that we have out there.
I'm Justin. I'm a local performer here. I just want to follow this thread of what next, and also just a little personal anecdote from our community with the Lantern Theater production. Actually, a lot of things really did, fruitful things came out of that that event. It didn't end at the letter, which might look like on paper that's what happened, but two big major things happened in our community. The first is there were a lot of Asian American performers, theater makers, technicians, designers, and people that identify with that community that all felt we were in our own little bubble because we feel very segregated both geographically, there's a lot of our city's very wide, but also artistically. And when this moment happened, there was a sudden a culling of voices. A lot of hands started going up, and people started being public on forums, on social media, and then we started making connections with each other, saying, hey, I don't know you, but we should all meet. And eventually we had a series of meetings between all of these artists, and those led to discussions on how do we deal with this issue. We have two options. We could do this in a public forum. We could have a town hall sort of gathering and talk with this artistic team, this theater, point out the things that were wrong with this production, or we could figure out a way to do this in a private manner. And ultimately, I think what we decided is what we decided was to do this in a small gathering, actually in this very room, with the artistic director, with the executive director, and a few of the staff, and a lot of our community, many of whom I had met for the very first time in those meetings. And this was all serendipitous with Rick Shiomi doing his residency at Interact, that actually just was happening at the same time, and the planning of the kata being here. But so after that there was a little bit of silence, but now there's a new initiative here in Philadelphia that he is actually spearheading, the executive director of the Lantern, to get together a lot of the artistic leaders from our theaters together to... I'm not sure what the next steps are, but that's the first stepping point. We're getting together this month, and who knows what's going to come of this. But I do want to say, like, there's the next steps for us. It was a strategy to come together and do this in a very private manner, and instead of a public way that some of these other incidents that you mentioned have been dealt with. But yeah.
Thank you. Interesting you mentioned the RSC Author No Show, so that really activated a whole bunch of a movement in the UK about 18 months, was it 2 years ago now? But you see, the RSC is an interesting, in the UK, it's interesting what you're saying about Seattle Rep, but a word of caution, the RSC would have a racial equality action plan, equal opportunities. It's set up to, you know, it's taken the money to, you know, to support diversity, etc. So, you know, so you have to be careful, allies may not be allies, firstly. Secondly, you know, being really shit hot on, you know, the people that are into the law, you know, the constitution. You know, I've gone into the RSC's memorandums, et cetera, and it's just a question about carrot and stick. There's no stick. You know, the RSC has held extensive actor workshops, has had lots of meetings with directors, et cetera, and hasn't employed anybody, to my knowledge, in the past year and a half. The two Chinese actors that moved the dog puppet, there's public in the Othno Zhao, there's public yes, we're going to, you know, these people come in this level, and they're going to be trained up to be Shakespearean actors, blah, blah, blah. Then as soon as their contract was over and the spotlight was off them, they were out on their ear. So I think that it's really interesting, it's great that here you're putting in mechanisms to support diversity and get pledges, but you have to be very careful about carrots and sticks, you know. So you had a bit of carrot, but you have that stick ready.
Oh, yeah. Ready.
I do have to move on soon. Super urgent, super urgent. Go for it, Marie Wren.
This is Marie Ran. Hi. This is actually a question, and so a lot of this coalition building and action that we've had in terms of a lot of the activities that have been going on around the country in terms of inequity. You know, what one of the questions that Andy Lowe brought up at one of the Los Angeles Network meetings that we had is how can we go past being reactionary and just being more and thinking about how can we be more proactive about what is our voice, what is the message. There are, of course, a lot of different points and a lot of goals that are all important, and so I think that's where a lot of intersectionality comes into place, and yeah, it's like how would we, you know, like I think it's really great that a lot of people are organizing right now because of, as a reaction, but to stay connected and to stay organized.
Thank you. And there's our segue. Okay. So, among other things, you can make a very good argument that the tone of the American theater is set by the Lort system. Everyone knows what that is, right? The legal resident theaters. They're basically the network of the major regional theaters of the United States, okay? Between them, they can give people careers, basically. They offer more equity contracts than Broadway and commercial theater combined. Okay, so if Vanya and Sonia Matcha Spike is the most produced play in the States this year, which I think it is, right, Broadway to there, well, it's not like Christian Rang needed the money, but you know, but the point is, that's the in, as it were, in terms of mainstream theater. So it's also then one logical area for activism, right? And going to Leilani's question, worth it, not, is worth talking about. So I'm gonna turn to Leslie now.
Oh, thank you, Jeff. It's a really interesting experience being on this panel because I come from starting out at the Northwest Asian American Theater in Seattle, which we have to look at the origins. It was first called the Exclusionary Act. So it was born out of activism. And I come from community activism, being in the Japanese American community there, and doing my part as a young adult to go to those redress hearings to connect us to the plenary that was just before us, and had family directly impacted by the internment. So a lot of my career has been a love of the arts for sure, but it was always, always based on activism. So I love, Jeff, that you've called upon me to get to at least open up this conversation around activism. There's a kind of a duality that I think occurs, like you're mentioning. I started at the Asian American Theater, but then I actually went to the started with Northwest Asian American Theater, and then was trained at the American Conservatory Theater in San Francisco. And I'll get into this a little bit more at the next breakout session on training. And that was at a time, and actually I really appreciate that Amelia is here, that was the start of a lot of the first conversations and gatherings on colorblind casting, when those terms were beginning. So to have been trained at a very predominantly white-based approach and really went through whitewashing and was actually told I won't work unless I speak a certain way, it was true at the time. It was true, and I have worked because of it. However, I live a double life that I think now is becoming more integrated because of my activism actually continued on. That I kept my other foot in the world of Asian American theater. And then one of the first things I did was I went to East West Players and met with Nobu McCarthy. And she said, you will teach. I had just come out of ACT. And she said, you will teach. And that's because I had the skills at the time that where most of us didn't have access. I was one of two people of color in my class at ACT at the time. And there were a couple above and behind me. So that average has not changed, unfortunately, when we talk about access. So when we look at the Laureate theaters, what are we training for? We're not getting access into the most major programs that actually utilize the MFA students, the candidates that come out. So it's an interesting prospect. Also, just to move over to I put this out to my panelists on an email. I said, am I wrong, or is it really only about 6 artistic directors of color in the Laureate system? Is it 5? I thought it was maybe Che Yu at Victory Gardens.
Victory Gardens is not technically.
Oh, that's right. It's not technically Laureate. Okay, thank you.
But he is an AD of a major. Yeah. Of a major.
Yes. Law. Thank you. Sheldon Epps, Pasadena Playhouse, Kwame Kwerma, Baltimore Center Stage, Joe Hodge, Playmakers Rep, Diane Paulus, ART, American Repertory Theater. She's half Japanese, which I didn't know, which I was so happy to learn. And of course, Tim Bond, Syracuse Stage. So that I just named 3 Asian Americans. Is there more? Oh, yes. I'm going to get to our associate. Thank you. Yes. Oh, she's artistic. Oh, yeah, that's right. Fantastic. Yes, and so, yay. There's a little bit of hope, Leilani. Associate Artistic Directors, Eric Ting at Long Wharf, Chris Aciba, who you saw in the video at Oregon Shakespeare Festival, Robert Fleming at Arena, he was just appointed to his position, Dan Rodriguez, which is an interesting story, finally just made Associate Artistic Director, and Sima Sueko at Pasadena Playhouse, Hannah Sharif, Center Stage, and then Liesl Tommy at Berkeley Rep. So there's a handful of people of color in these positions in the Laureate theaters, which is, I believe, 72 theaters active in this country. So while that's more than there has been in the past, and that's hopeful, Jeff asked me the question, what's the vision? You know, is there a percentage we're shooting for? And in some talks with other colleagues, I'm not sure that's actually the question. Why I think we should be goal-driven, it helps us to rise to the occasion. To have something to look for, because we can get very ensconced in our own internalized oppression and be reactive. So to be literally the activism, to be proactive is really interesting to be able to think about our vision. I think the bigger question, and I share this with colleagues, Sharifa is one, is how and do we prioritize developing our top leadership? And in what context? Because the context has been largely in the mainstream that was developed by the white, really,
as our colleague just mentioned, supremacist mentality. And if we're the coming majority, then in what context do we actually train our people? I'm really excited to think about my vision, which is a state-of-the-art national theater for people of color. If you look around at the nation, I've had the good fortune in the last few years to travel for different programming and see the state of the people of color theaters in this country. We deserve more. I love seeing this building and that there's newness to it, but most of us need a sound system. Most of us haven't changed out our carpeting. Most of us, thankfully, at East West, we're a historical site, and there are some ramifications about what we can change there. But we are living and inhabiting theaters that are not up to date, and it's shameful. And it's not necessarily our fault. It's not for not having tried. It's unconscionable. And we are the coming majority, and here's where the hope is, Leilani. Thank you for bringing that up. We have been doing this for years, and we actually know what to do. We've been in our communities. We've been giving voice. We're making a decision to be visible despite the challenges. We're starting to see how our liberation is connected to each other, which is critical. These are not one-offs that happen. It's been systematic. And we have to look back at our history and not just see where the victimization is, but how we're connected because of it and begin to build our liberation based on that. We have to, and I sound old school, I know, but it's actually so relevant to keep bringing up the term liberation. I think it's important that we take a moment here to breathe and look back at our generations and see the DNA that has come through all of us. It's so fortunate that Tisa will travel to be with us and that she represents the generations that started our Asian American theaters. And we have to note that what she keeps bringing up are things that have been left behind that still need time and energy, integrated with all the incredible, wonderful energy that comes from our younger generations. And I know we'll get to that in the intergenerational breakout session. We're community organizers. We always have been. So I'm really excited to see how the community organizing is going on and how different we look than we were in Los Angeles last time. I can feel it. And I have to share with you that in Los Angeles, we're 91% students of color in the educational system now. I have the great fortune of straddling working with major institutions like Center Theater Group, one of the largest consortium of theaters in this country, Oregon Shakespeare, probably, if not the first or second behind them, larger consortium of theaters in this country, and then working with Asian American theater. And the white mainstream is very quickly, in terms of language, because I'm a voice teacher, is losing currency. Students will speak English in the classroom because they have to, around their subject. But they actually silo off by language. And usually when I'm in the classroom, and this is the great thing about getting to see the whole landscape, is there's usually no less than 6 to 12 languages in the room. It's incredibly exciting. And if you haven't been out to California, I hope you come, because you start to feel, I've been starting to feel more agency because I'm finally in the majority. We're in the majority there now, so we're the leading edge and developing all of the strategizing of what it's going to mean in 2042, which is now our prediction around majority. So I hope you keep and work with us and keep a close eye on what we're doing, because language is a very big key to how we keep connected to each other and keep sharing and cross-pollinating around that, not to dilute and become Asian enough or white enough, but keep connecting around who we are. And for me as a Japanese American, that means reclaiming my language. Because of internment, we stopped speaking Japanese. So, you know, looking at language, looking at the coming population, and we are it. I want to ask a quick question before I throw it back to Jeff, is how many feel that they have agency some of the time? How many feel you have agency half the time in your livelihood? How many feel you have agency all the time? Oh, wow. I'd like everybody to raise their hand right now. Everybody, raise your hand. I'm asking you now to raise your hand and to remember this moment, because I have just now deemed you with full agency all the time, every moment. Every moment, you must give yourself agency. And never forget that. And after I just gave you permission, you now have to own it. So I want you to breathe that in right now. Breathe it right now. Everybody, please, a collective breath in. And now a big sigh saying, yes, I accept that. Because we won't move forward without it. But we are looking different from the last conference. I'm starting to see agency. And I only hope that we just continue on through this movement, through this conference, to practice giving ourselves agency, working with each other, and making our connection strong. Thank you, Jeff.
Yes. Yeah. So no, that brings us back directly to Lulani's question. I'm going to ask you guys to participate again. And thank you so much for participating. I wanted it to be like this. I think it's working out. It's like if everyone's quiet, it's like, No. yeah. The question of, right, this sort of community-based model versus the, how do we break into the mainstream, and then how do those things kind of support each other is a very interesting one, because I do feel very strongly that both are necessary, you know what I mean? So you asked about, okay, if you're doing the community-based stuff, right, if you can prove that you have an audience and a market of your own, well, then, do you know what I mean? They'll come to you because they want the money. Right? That's always been a problem with Asian Americans relative to population and ticket buying power. This is a fact. Do you know what I mean? I always bring up, you know what, if you're an entrepreneur, that's an incredible skill. Tyler Perry, however you think about his work, he does not need the approval of Lort. He does not need the approval of white critics. Do you know what I mean? And he started as a theater artist, not a filmmaker. Not a phone book, a theater artist. He knew his audience. He knew where they were. He sidestepped all of that stuff, right? And now no one can ignore him and everybody wants to have a development deal. If you can prove that, you're on your way. It's difficult in the Asian American situation relative to population. This is why one of the things I want to throw out as well is that traditionally, film, TV, web, I'm going to add web to that now, and theater, people are wary of that relationship, right? Well, guess what? The web is actually the one place where Asian Americans are overrepresented relative to population. Okay, what does that tell you about market, right? And it's beyond, okay, we have to use social media for marketing, because I have it on very good authority that actually the people who are online, they're very allergic to marketing. They don't like to feel like they're being marketed to. What it really is it's another place to generate content which creates engagement. Okay, so I want to throw that thought out there for, you know, the later marketing panels and stuff like that, because I think it's a very important distinction. I think a lot of theaters only see it as marketing, and I don't know that that's actually the right way to explore that sphere, which is huge. It's much bigger in the future than now. The other thing I want to point out in terms of hope is, and you've been looking at the major networks lately, ABC arguably now has the most diverse slate of fall shows in the history of American television. That did not happen by accident. It's years of activism, it's the NAACP, it's the Asian Pacific American Media Coalition, and it's also the zeitgeist catching up with the national and global population, slowly but surely. And I would encourage us to think of theater as part of all of that. In fact, part of the progenitor, since theater came first, but it's not the enemy. When we presented Yellow Face for YouTube at TCG, David Henry Wong, one of our most prominent playwrights, was saying, you know what, I'm not threatened by this web stuff at all. He even said, I don't even care if people want to take little clips of my shows, because it's all going to generate interest in theater. I don't know that I agree with that necessarily, but that's what he said, so I'm passing it on to you. I'll get to you. The other thing about Lort is that we do need people who want to play that game, you know? It's a strange place to be. How do you climb the ladder and maintain that identity? But without people like David Henry Wong, I don't know that we'd be further than where we are now. But it's not everybody. You need to know how to and want to play that particular game. We need playwrights who are designing shows that are for crossover. Do you know what I mean? It's not every play that's going to do that. That's just the reality. The mainstream theaters are not going to produce certain kinds of Asian American plays, and they will do others. And that's a conversation we can have. But we can be very savvy about that. And I think the community route and the mainstream route can work together if the right sort of leadership is in place. So I throw that out there. Okay. Looking forward towards 2020 and even 2042, right, which is when America becomes majority-minority. What do we want to see? But first, do you have comments on this topic? Why don't we do that now before we move on? Okay, yeah.
Can I just answer that really quick?
Yeah, so there's one.
Before I forget. I want to see us track the people in Spark. Our Asian American leaders in Spark, our Asian American leaders coming up that especially make note of our generational, intergenerational breakout, I want us to track them and make sure they get somewhere. We have to start tracking our people. We have to start giving that push to make sure they're supported throughout their process. Yep.
Yeah. Let's hear some folks. Got urgent hands up.
I just want to thank you all so much. I just want to thank you all. And I actually want to want us to take that agency that Leslie has given us and say, we don't need to play the Lort game. What I want us to do is to take that agency and be rebels and revolutionaries and be artists and say, that system is already struggling. Why are we not trying to build something else up? Why are we not supporting our institutions? Because guess what? What we want is those buildings and those spaces and those resources, they're shuttering. And if we build up our companies, we can take those over and create new models. I just think it's a broken system and model, and we still keep trying to fight for it, and it's not our audiences, and it's not our community. And I just think that we have to think outside, you know, I encourage us to think outside of the box. I think this conference, this gathering is outside of that box. And I know we want to make a living wage, and it's hard to be artists these days, but I think don't compromise who you are to be in those places is ultimately what we should not do.
I just want to thank you so much for saying that. That was way more articulate than the two sentences I will say, which is, I encourage all of us to be bad Asians, bad Asians, in the Evo Ishii sense, because I think that's the only way that we'll be able to do what Grace Lee Boggs says, which is a revolution is possible if our imagination is expansive enough. We are such creative people, and I can't agree with you more. We don't need to rebuild what we have that is shitty and poops on us. Why don't we imagine something that is amazing and is for tomorrow and for our communities and for our children? That was a lot longer than two sentences. I'm sorry.
Just to kind of go on this Lort thing. But really, for those of you, and I work with Theater Communications Group that supports the not-for-profit theater, which includes Lort Theaters and all. To put it in perspective, there are 1,800 professional theaters in this country. The LORT universe is approximately 70, so you can see that it is a very small percentage of the ecosystem. But I also do want to say that we are an ecosystem. You lift and support and rise together. All boats rising on the water together. That if we start to become divisive and say, well, you bad there, us community theater, good here, that is essentially falling into the trap of racism and oppression that has been dogging us from day one. So I want us to recognize the ecosystem in that way. The other thing is within the LORT world, I mean, they are, waking up and seeing what the zeitgeist is right now. There has been a LORT diversity task force that has been in place for the last couple, since last year, and they've been having racial equity workshops, and a lot of this has been really pushed into place by Tim Bond and Joe Hodge, who are, artistic directors of note, and then largely supported by strong allies at OSF and Steppenwolf and other places around. So there are, don't demonize, because there are people within the LORT structure that have the same values that everybody else does. And just lastly, I think the spark thing has been thrown around a little bit. I just wanted to give a shout out because Victor Mayog, Snehal Desai, and then also Nelson Eusebio, who are not here, are part of TCG's pilot year of the Spark Leadership Program, specifically targeting leaders who aim to be the executive and artistic directors of theaters. And our hope is that within 3 to 5 years of completing the program, they're going to be in major leadership positions in our theaters. And these are 10 incredible people, and we've got 3 Asian Americans out of 10. I didn't have a thing to do with that.
So I wanted to just build off of the last 3 points. I think it is striking balance, because I do believe in the concept that we need good people everywhere, yes. And I don't think it's an old school thing to throw out the word liberation. And I just always want to remember the term self-determination. In all of these cases, we're self-determining our actions. And I think it comes down to percentages of time. So we're all going to take different percentages of time fighting different battles. Me personally, I'm going to definitely support instances where folks have to challenge representation issues in larger systems of power. But it's going to be a smaller percentage of my time. Do you know what I mean? I want to spend way more on, yes, holding people accountable to public funds and leveraging that towards development in our communities. But beyond that, it's like, I don't want to deal with what's gross. Like, they're just going to be gross. They're going to continue to be gross and not even think that they have to think about that. And so, yeah, I just want to create and collaborate and just be self-determined. And yes, I do feel agency all the time. Yes, absolutely. So, yeah. But balance and loving each other.
This is such a rich and beautiful discussion, and one of the things you mentioned, Tyler Perry, and one of the things that I had the luxury of getting a show produced at a local theater in D.C., where they decided to do a new ticketing policy, Forum Theater. Half of all seats were pay what you want. And still, they were not, the show before, they were not getting people to come into the theater. And so I, along with a few other people, spearheaded using community organizing strategies as a tool for getting new, quote-unquote, audiences, basically people around the corner they weren't talking to, into the theater that they were uncomfortable talking to. And so we basically created a whole team, a volunteer team of people who were inspired enough by the content of the play because it actually spoke to them about issues going on in their communities. And then more and more people came. It was sold out. It was the most diverse audience that one woman, executive director, Nan Barnett, had ever seen in her 40 years of going to theater. Now, of course, I don't know what theater she was going to, too, as well. You know, obviously, that's all, whatever. But it really spoke to something. And it made a difference to not only the performance, it enriched the experience of each other person in the audience. That, the mms and the what people were responding to, it enriched that tapestry of the experience of the audience and also the post-show discussion because people got a chance to know each other deeper. And I feel like it was something that I wish more theaters were open to doing. Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah, go for it. I just wanted to say, someone gave me this piece of advice. If you have a chance, take a leadership position. If you have a chance, even if you don't want that, take a leadership position, because it's a rare opportunity. And I haven't worked in the Lord Theater. I ran a theater program in Cleveland, Mississippi for 3 summers in the Deep South. And suddenly that, I think everything I do is a Filipino play, right? And so suddenly the way that people were having a relationship with me and my relationship to the Secret Garden and to the folks who were coming to this program changed. I ran a training program for 5 years in Colorado, and suddenly the tone of the staffing and who was making the decisions changed. So I don't really always want to be in charge. But someone gave me that advice maybe 15 years ago. And it's been hard, because sometimes I just want to lay back. But I know that when I can change that, you know, the priorities in the budgets, change the priorities in terms of what the pie is going to be, or who that scholarship money can go to, it makes a big difference. So that's my 2 cents for you.
Hi, my name is Gina Pisasal. I'm a resident dramaturg at a Lort Theater in Philadelphia, People's Lightning Theater Company. And just to speak to your initiative to reach out to community, I feel like we're saying Lort as a kind of unit force, but as like a Lort Theater in the suburb of Philadelphia, we're outside of Philadelphia too. There's a certain uniqueness and a certain localness to us. And there's a certain individuality that I think we need in our conversation about diversity and inclusion that other, like even Philadelphia theaters or OSF or, you know, Chicago, like has different conversations and different needs by different communities. And it's obviously fueled by the individual artists that are there. So I kind of just want to acknowledge that we can bring our own kind of local sensibility to our work. And what I've, I'm doing PhD work as well, what I'm kind of doing that research of is when the, what is thrown at us in terms of responsibility to the larger Asian American culture. So when you have an Asian American dramaturg in the room working on an Asian American piece, like what am I, and I'm adopted Korean, but for some reason, I become the expert on Asian American culture in the room. So when you're saying, like, it's so interesting to name all of these individuals that are rising in the ranks, but to know that they also come with their individual sensibilities about art, so that we have people of color in place of power is great on a visual level, but in terms of bringing the individual sensibilities, we have to, I think, account for that and not assume that our priorities are going to be kept and kind of put forward by people just because they're in those places of power. So I just want to kind of acknowledge the local kind of movement that's necessary, I think, in the regional theaters, and that's why the regional theater started, because they wanted to address communities in these different cities, you know? So I think we all have different needs, and we all have really individual groups of artists, like in Philadelphia, that we need to, like, we can't have the same conversation that Seattle's having, because we're not majority Asian, you know? So there's a local conversation, I think, that needs to happen within every institution.
One thing I was going to say is that, if we look at, like, what is our vision for 2020 or, 2042, it's what I love about coming to these conferences is so many passionate artists at heart, creative people. It's us being able to create the work that we want to experience, right? If you start with what your vision, your passion is, and make that a reality, that's what excites people about wanting to connect to that work. But I also want to say, in terms of agency aspect,
because sometimes it's like, you know, Leilani, you know, like, where is there hope? I'm doing the stuff I'm passionate about, but are the people coming? And I think there's a whole paradigm shift that's happening in terms of the funding world. And that they are, I am also a funder, we can be your allies as well. And that what I've noticed, though, is a lot of times with communities of color, because of the institutionalized structures that have always existed, there's been this divide where people feel like, oh, I can't approach that because that represents the mainstream society. But the reality is the whole conversation, there's a huge paradigm shift. I'm heading straight out of here to the Grantmakers and the Arts Conference, and all of us, the biggest question we're grappling at the conference is equity, diversity, and the changing demographics, and how do we actually make sure that we're engaging the people who are actually at the community level doing work that is going to engage all the different diverse communities that we want to reach out to. But a lot of them feel like they don't know how to reach out into community. So I'm inspiring all of you to reach out to them. Don't think that just because of the big Ford Foundation or any local funder that you go to that they're too out there and they're too much representative of the government or whatever. Reach out to them because they are actually craving that. They want to hear what your ideas are. They want to know what's new, what's different, what's inspiring, how the work is evolving, and how it's addressing the current issues of the day, which are not these institutions way back here, but are the people doing the groundmaking work. And I think that's how we'll shift it. If you get funders to hear your stories, they're going to get passionate about how can we support this work, and that's where the paradigm will really shift.
I just want to follow on from that there is a language of funders and funding. So I have been a consultant for the Arts Council England for about 5-6 years now to learn that language. So it's not for everybody, but for those, you know, certainly those with producer bents, learning the language that funders and the people in power use is a very helpful thing. I think the points I'd like to make is, firstly, there's lots of talk about the US becoming, you know, the minority becoming the majority, but today we're already are in the global majority. You know, if you add together the Asians all around the world, we are in that global majority. And those that want to claim that heritage of being in the global majority, can, you know, just something for people to consider. I think the second point I'd like to make is around the balance between the collective vision and uniqueness. There's something about the uniqueness of being an artist or being a curator or being a funder working in this area. And I think it's celebrating and supporting that uniqueness and yet having a collective vision to support that. It's quite an interesting, different mix, you know, being of Asian descent. We come from societies that were more collective. And I don't know, that's something, a thought that came through. The final point I'd like to make is that, you know, these theatres of different sizes, I don't understand the terminology, but I mean, there's basic economics that, you know, we are professionals, so we're creating something and we want to sell it for more than what we created it for. So I don't see any issue with people wanting to create product or stories or whatever to sell to Lourdes or to Broadway or to the West End, China, Japan, I don't know, all over the world, really. So I think, you know, that basic entrepreneurialness, I want to sell to my things I do to as many people as possible. That's bums on seats. And I don't see there's any, you know, I'm in America, for goodness sakes. I'm almost feeling like, am I in America here? With all this community, this, that, and the other, which is great. I'm one of those too. But where are the people that want to make money? Are they in this room? Are there any? If any of those people come and find me and let's make some money.
So I used to be a grant maker at the San Francisco Foundation. I just want to echo what you said. Funders in general, including at Ford, the big foundations, are very receptive to meeting with grant seekers, and actually they need to. It's their job. And their job also includes site visits, not just with people they're currently granting, but potential grant applicants. And when I was at the San Francisco Foundation, we would meet with grant seekers many, many times per week, if we had enough time, read proposals, give feedback. And there's actually a lot of parallel between the theater community in the US and the philanthropy community, because it's quite small, and so funders know each other within cities and across the country. I mean, you're going to see a lot of people I know next week. But also, philanthropy is facing very similar issues around race. For those of you who might be interested in funding a nonprofit, admin or leadership of the San Francisco Foundation has a, I hate the what it's called, but it's called that. It's the Multicultural Fellowship Program. And there are six two-year fellowships designed to cultivate young leaders of color in philanthropy and nonprofit leadership. I won't go into all the different programs, but one is arts and culture. So if you or you know of anyone or you yourself are interested, Google it or talk to me. And then in terms of where in 2020 or 2040, so my experience of being Asian American and Japanese American in this country is being is having a white mother, having an aunt born in northern Mexico, having a Panamanian uncle, having a black uncle from southern Georgia who has claimed me as his son and introduces me as such to everybody in Georgia, and his entire family in southern Georgia claims me as their own. And so in terms of ethnically specific theater, you know, I feel like I don't fit in anywhere, and I feel like there are more and more of us. I was at, two nights ago, hanging out with Rick Shiomi and Roger, and with Chris Chen and Jessica Wong, and it was interesting how Rick and Roger were there, and then three young playwrights are all Hapa. And I have a Hapa friend who's Filipina and black. And I have, one of my best friends is Bengali, and his wife is Guatemalan. And so, I don't know where to go with that, but I do want to shout out and give props to Campo Santo in San Francisco, which was founded some years ago by Sean San Jose, who's performing tonight at Tree City Legends. He's Filipino-American, two Latinos, and Margot Hall, who's African-American. That was were the four founding members. And they, I would argue that they're an ethnically specific theater because all of their theater is quote-unquote ethnic, but all of their theater is also multiracial. And Tree City Legends, it's three brothers who are supposed to be Korean, but there's one Korean actor, Sean, who's Filipino, and a Latino actor. And I mean, that's, you know, Obama, for me, is nothing new, and his family and his half-Indonesian sister is nothing new, and I'm sure it's not new for most of us. Anyway, that's all.
He's not new, but it's new that he's the president. Right? Okay. Let's bring it back to the panel. 2020 or 2042, if you like, what do you want to see? What do you think you will see?
I mean, what I'd like to see is more theaters, more people taking control into their hands, the agency part. It's like, okay, not relying upon outsiders just to generate, you know, the organizing principles, that I can do this myself. You can do this yourself. And that's how I got started, because I decided, well, what's stopping me from doing this? Absolutely nothing. And while I'm not, you know, I'm not a million, I don't have $1 million budget, I'm still producing theater. I think it's, you know, culturally relevant to my era. So that's what I want to see. I also want to be able to see, going back to that, you know, relating to the mainstream, it's like being a little more prepared to deal with these, shall we call questionable instances, of which there's so many, there have been so many of them, and not be so shocked about that. It's like, okay, you know, just maybe be a little, that may take a little cynical view of saying, okay, we know it's going to happen. So, you know, some people have not had the opportunity to be enlightened. So let's be prepared to enlighten people with a prepared, you know, curriculum, as they say, to try to educate people. So.
Good question, Jeff. He keeps asking me this question. I would like to see resource come to theaters of color, Asian American theaters, to allow us to grow to be state of the art. I would like to see us grow our networks so that we all see ourselves as leaders, because it's my belief that if you take leadership, and leadership can be many things, you actually contradict victimization. And so that means to strengthen our networks, to keep growing and growing and growing. We are everywhere.
I think for me, it's okay to be a little bit pissed off. And to say something truthful. I've worked with some more mainstream partnerships, and that's been very, very helpful in you for 2G. But I know it's really a true partnership when the contract comes in and it's not like a one-shot deal. And that you can say that to them. And then you just keep on going back. I think being a little bit pissed off is good, right? And also demanding more and actually being curious where you think you don't belong, find a way to belong. That's the way that I've gotten to so many of these other places, just because of my own naivete that I didn't even know, right? So what I've been trying to do as I've gotten older is actually claim some of that naivete so I can go to places that I don't think I should be, to ask for things that people might not even know they weren't giving me. That's what I'm hoping for. And dollars? Yes. Yes, of course. All those things that make these ideas move. Because we're not going to move away from the sort of the default of Christianity as what this was founded on. Capitalism that this was founded on. And all the other things, right? Transaction that New York City was founded on. I'll give you a bunch of, you know, I'll give you some beads for all this land. People are looking at those things. So let's not also ignore some of those origin stories.
The other panel, something that struck me is they were talking about forgiveness, right? And I would definitely agree with all of that because it's, you know, much more healthy in the long run. But I also think that the other side of that is that forgiveness on its own doesn't get the job done. It's power, right? You're going to have to accumulate power one way or another. And I know other people will say, no, there have to be alternatives. Okay, fair enough. But for instance, if we talk about, many of you are very passionate about these sort of alternative to lords, right? They've still got to be funded somehow. So if you can't fund it just through your ticket sales, meaning entrepreneurial, then essentially you do have to become funding activists, right? Now, the funders are coming around, but you're still going to have to learn to play that game, which may be just as much work as breaking into the Lord. Like, don't fool yourself about that. But it can be done. You know what I'm saying? But I mean, be realistic about, okay, if you want to do this completely outside of the box thing, you've still got to answer that fundamental question. And what are the allies that will get you there strategically?
Yes.
Right? Right. Okay. 12:45. I think this has been a great discussion. I want to thank all the panelists and the Asian American Arts Initiative. Please take this agency to the rest of the conference and back home. Thank you.